Ocelot spleen.
Got me nuts.
I haven't got me nuts, sorry. I've got wren's livers, badger spleen.
No, no, no.
Otter's noses?
I don't want that Roman rubbish.
Why don't you sell proper food?
Proper food?
Yeah, not those rich imperialist tidbits.
Oh, don't blame me. I didn't ask to sell this stuff.
All right, bag of otter's noses then.
I get two.
Two.
Thanks, Rick.
Are you the Judean people's front? Fuck off.
What?
Judean people's front. For the people's front of Judea. Judean people's front. Wankers.
Can I join your group?
No, piss off.
I didn't want to sell this stuff. It's only a job. I hate the Romans as much as anybody.
Are you sure?
Oh, dead sure. I hate the Romans already. Listen, if you wanted to join the PFJ, you'd have to really hate the Romans. I do.
Oh, yeah? How much?
A lot.
Right, you're in.
Listen, the only people we hate more than the Romans, the fucking Judean people's front.
Yes. Yes.
And fucking the Judean popular people's front.
Oh, yes. Yes.
And the people's front of Judea.
Yes. Yes.
The people's front of Judea. Splitters.
We're the people's front of Judea.
Oh, I thought we were the popular front.
People's front.
Whatever happened to the popular front?
Eh? He's over there.
So, that, my friends, is the intro to tonight's talk. I'm hoping to have a little bit of fun with this before I dive into the deep end. Let's be fair. When you try and have a conversation about changing the world, try to have a conversation with people about what it is that this progressive movement is all about, what it's supposed to do. What do you want to get from it, right? What do you want your family to get from it? What is it that you're looking to achieve? You've got a lot of religion. You got a lot of splitters. You got a lot of divisiveness. You got a lot of people that have a religious belief in things that may or may not have any validity whatsoever. It's a core belief, not a fact, not science, not truth, just a belief. Many on the left despise religion. You get all the snarky, condescending discussions about Sky Daddy and, you know, the fake Jesus, and wouldn't it be rape if God really took the Virgin Mary? And you get all the other stuff that, you know, the condescending stuff against Christianity, which is fine. People are allowed to do what they want to do. But the point is, they're attacking beliefs. And why are they attacking these beliefs? It's partially because they, you know, they don't like the politics behind it. It's partially because it's not necessarily fact-based. It can't be proven. Can't be a lot of things. But that is what the left often does. It walks into a conversation about what they want to see. And they're not starting from a position of, well, what's the real deal? They're coming with their Bible in hand, their own lefty version of the Bible. And they're telling you how it is. They can't back up a lot of it. A lot of it's just made up. Fireside chats with a bunch of people that took some LSD one night. Whatever it is, it's stuff that's been handed down. And just like when you try to tell a Christian something against their faith, or you try and tell a Muslim something against their faith, or a Jew against their faith, etc., you get the visceral reaction, that lashing out that you only get when you violate someone's hard-earned belief system. And this is where it's like, my beliefs, your beliefs, oh, it's all, you know, speculative, right? Some of it is, some of it's not. There is truth out there. There is facts. But the left walks into every conversation as a full cup. A full cup you can't add anything else to. You pour more into it and it just goes all over the floor, makes a big mess. The only way that you can actually learn something new is to get rid of the old shit, the garbage that's filling your mind. Keep the important stuff that is provable, fact-based, truth-based, and allow new information to come in. Now, going back to when I was a kid, you know, I followed Metallica around like they were God. Anything James Hetfield said was like it was a spoken from God. Anything that Metallica did was as if God himself had spoken it. Same thing with people like Dave Mustaine of Megadeth and Maynard James Keenan of Tool. Any of these band guys back in the day, man, they made you feel like the words were coming and there was just no other possible truth than what you heard. And a lot of the stuff, with all due respect to them, was gibberish. You know, a lot of the stuff they said spoke to a young man's rebellion, spoke to a young guy's heart that wanted to just lash back at mom and dad for being too hard on him. But the reality is that there's a point in time where you start shedding a boy's angst. You start bringing on a man's reality. You start bringing on an adult's reality. And you have to either A, you can be that old curmudgeon that sits there in a dark room bitching about everything. No facts involved. They're not interested in solutions. They've just gotten so jaded with the world that the only answer that is right at all is it's all got to go. It's all got to be burned down. There's nothing of value here. I know you know what I'm talking about. This is a teenager's mindset. You know, they don't understand. So rather than actually try to understand, they just sort of say things, right? Now, you'd like to believe that that mindset vanished in youth, that that was just the mind of a youth, you know, just that angst and the anger and the rage of not being able to express it. And it comes out in music or it comes out in some TV show or it comes out in some new edgy trend. But let me tell you, as adults, we see it in a great many things. I'm going to talk about Bitcoin for a minute. Now, Bitcoin, I've seen a lot of friends made an awful lot of money buying low, holding, selling, whatever. They used it as an investment and they made money. Good for you. I had a lot of friends when I was growing up in the telecom industry who were close to vendors like Cisco and, you know, Alcatel and Lucent, Juniper. A lot of these folks that really were close to these things bought low, made a fortune. They're living out there in McLean, Virginia now in some McMansion, you know. And the rest of us, we missed, right? We missed the big opportunity to win by throwing some money at this gamble and winning on the other side. That's an investment. And when I try to explain to people that the United States government alone is the one that can create laws and can create the dollar, and therefore by which demand payment be made in the dollar and pay your taxes in the dollar, and that the United States dollar, whether they turned it into a cryptocurrency, use it in quarters, nickels, and dimes, or pieces of paper, or personal cards, or some freaking chip they insert in your forehead that you have scanned, or whether it be in your wrist with a barcode, whatever the next generation of government crap is, it doesn't matter. It's just a technology. You can call it the dollar, you can call it the bureau, you can call it the bellyache, I don't care. The bottom line is that the government's unit of account is not gonna crash. The government's unit of account is tied to the real resources of the nation. It's tied to the government's ability to do what it wants to do, which is set the price to provision itself. And I got into a long conversation with a good friend tonight. They came to me and they had a million things. So I'm going to read some of this. I'm not going to mention his name because it would be wrong, because he wasn't being a jerk. He just didn't know any better. But I want to read this to you. And here we go. Let me pull it up. Well, I'd like to find it. What did I do with it? Did I delete it? I don't think I did. I think it's right here. I just have to get through the millions of these inboxes that I have. Here we go. So he goes, starts off, you can't just keep printing money and hoping all is well. Then he says, our current financial system is imploding. Few seem to realize it. Like he's got this inside track on something nobody else would know. And I'm like, how do you know the secret? Anyway, he goes, you can't just keep printing money and hoping all is well. Taxes should be illegal, in my opinion. Taken by force seems anywhere else is a crime. But not the government. They take whatever they decide they want. Income tax was what? Put in play to pay for wars, never meant to be something that was supposed to affect every person for their entire lives. Our government borrows money against it. They take out of our paychecks for Social Security as they please, and is on the verge of taking money out of Social Security checks from people. Is that okay? Righteous anger, right? And then I say, listen, dude, lots of shoulds, little understanding. I mean this in the nicest way possible. You cannot learn new things if you're approaching a subject from a point of thinking that you know everything. I am literally in the know on this. And I am telling you point by point, you're wrong. Now, he goes, okay, so what exactly am I wrong about? Now, the list was long. Everything he said down to the nth was literally wrong. Literally wrong. He says, the government doesn't take money out of Social Security? And I said, wow, this is too much to do in chat, my friend. I said, but no, it doesn't. Not one penny. Because Social Security is nothing more than a spreadsheet. Oh boy, that set the trail afire. I said, read this again. And I had sent him a tweet that I had made. And I said, print more money. It's a circuit. It's a circuit. A government spends money into existence via appropriations. Then it taxes some of it out of existence. If government spending is printing money, then government taxation is unprinting money. Now, he goes, I said, now I want you to read this link. I said, will you promise me you'll read this link? And I sent him Warren Mosler's 7 Deadly Innocent Frauds. And I said, read this link and then you and I can have a conversation. Because to get you to the point where we could have this conversation on even footing would require a tremendous amount of texting on a touchscreen phone that I just don't have the patience for, quite frankly. So he comes back a little while later, and I thought that he was going to wait till the morning, but I guess he jumped on it. He goes, okay, I read the first 15 pages and I understand as much. He goes, makes a lot of sense, Steve. Going to bed, I'll talk to you in the morning. I thought that was pretty cool. He came barreling into the conversation full of beliefs, lots of beliefs, none of which were founded in an ounce of truth. A lot of folklore that people pass around, but none of it was truthful. He's not a liar. Guy's a nice guy. He's one of my friends. I care about him immensely. He's just wrong. He just doesn't understand. So for those of you who are interested in learning about Social Security, go to Warren Mosler's book, Seven Deadly Innocent Frauds, and go to Innocent Fraud number 4. And you'll learn all about it. It's kind of hard to explain to folks that the government takes money out for Social Security, keeps a running log of how much you've dumped into it. But what they don't tell you is, like with all of these things, it's just keystrokes. It's just electronic digits. They're deleted from the system. And when you need to receive your first payment, they're keystroked into existence. There's no logical tie-in to the amount you put in and the amount you get out. Now, we may do this so that you feel good about buying into the process. But there is no Ponzi scheme, because the government is the wellspring from which all the money comes from. Is that clear? That's a pretty straightforward answer right there, right? The money starts with keystrokes out of thin air. The metalists, for those of you who don't know, that's the commodity-based money people. The people that are like, well, you're going to devalue my dollar. What's the value of the dollar? What is backing the dollar? It's got to be gold. It's got to be oil. It's got to be something. No, we have a tax-driven currency, just like all fiat currencies are, that are free-floating. Okay? This isn't like religion. This is straight up like, I don't really have a dog in this fight. It can be good. It can be bad. It can be whatever. It just is. There's no religion here. Sorry, folks, I wish it were a cult. It's not. It's just operational reality. So what is the obsession with believing that the government's running out of money, that Social Security is going to go bankrupt? What is the religious reason why we do this? The doomsday sales pitch resonates with people every freaking day, just like the religious people believe that Armageddon's coming and the end of the world is nigh. It's here. When the four horsemen of the apocalypse come, we have a fetish for end of days, that we're in some unique group of people that has the keys to the kingdom to survive the apocalypse. And it is this strange, bizarre behavior that permeates our existence, as advanced as we think we are. So much of what we do is religion. It's straight up religion. We have gotten ourselves into such a situation that we are more addicted to the beliefs that we've created or have been passed on by mama, that we will resist at all costs new information. Now, one of the things that I've been noticing also within this movement is that when you talk to people about cryptocurrency in general, there are those people out there who say it's a great investment, and they understand that they're betting on the market, man. But then there's other people that really believe that this cryptocurrency is going to supplant the US dollar, that it's going to knock the US dollar out of existence. And then they point to countries that are in bringing about their own crypto style currency. There is an underlying architecture called blockchain. Okay, this is a technology. There's nothing whatsoever, other than maybe they don't want to, from preventing our government from turning the US dollar into a blockchain friendly unit of account. It could do that. Central banks could choose to do this. Will they? Maybe they will, maybe they won't. It doesn't much matter. What does matter is that when we talk about fighting for a progressive agenda, when I think of that, I think of equality. I think about the basic needs of all citizens, from education to food to shelter to healthcare. I think about making sure our infrastructure is sound and solid and well-maintained. I think about every citizen having access to a guaranteed job. I think of expanding Social Security so that every person that needs an income can have an income, whether they're capable of working or not. I support a great many things, but none of those, not one, from green energy to eliminating student debt, is going to be achieved by a private cryptocurrency. Why is that? First of all, the U.S. government is the creator of the dollar. It can create as many dollars as it needs to, and it can wipe out whatever debt it wants to. The other thing, quite frankly, is that the cryptocurrencies out there are on wild swings, flying all around, up and down. So you'll never see someone say, well, you know, I bought that car for 12 Bitcoin. You're going to see them use their Bitcoin maybe to exact the transaction, just like PayPal or any number of things. The difference is it's just a store of account. It's like an envelope that holds U.S. dollars, if you will. This is not the technical definition, so all the fetishizers with the neck beards can slow down. Down, Simba. I'm giving an analogy. Neck beards, chillax. So what we're talking about here, though, is a commodity. It's being bought and sold and traded. Why do people like gold? Because it rises in value. Why do people like old Cisco stock? Because it rose in value and it kept splitting and splitting and splitting. People were becoming paper millionaires overnight. Does anybody remember the dot-com era? Does anybody remember the speculative economy? Does anybody remember all the people that were buying and selling stocks and getting rich on dot-coms? I was surrounded by them. So when we look at this, and I tell you, guys, I don't care whether you invest in Bitcoin or not. That's not my deal. You start cutting away the reality. The reality is that the anarcho-libertarians, the crypto-fascists, are looking to bring the government down. They think they're bringing the government to its knees through a private sector solution, a free market solution. Now ask yourself, if you're a socialist or you are in some way, shape, or form fighting for a new deal, a green new deal, Medicare for all, free college, national infrastructure, a job guarantee, expanded Social Security, hell, housing. Imagine telling me in your best religious voice that Bitcoin is going to supplant the US dollar to do that. This is the kind of religion that we're dealing with. There's no basis in fact for any of that. Bitcoin cannot get rid of $1.4 trillion in student loans. If Bitcoin was so great, right now Puerto Rico desperately needs help. Why haven't we used Bitcoin to bail out the Puerto Ricans? Think about it, because it's not a state currency. It's not. It is an investment. It is a commodity. And it's creating a new set of wealthy people that you can't stand. Remember, you want to tax the shit out of the wealthy? Or was that only in some other religious sect? You don't mind a new breed of quote unquote billionaires, Bitcoin billionaires, who have to trade their Bitcoin for dollars for it to be effective. Think about the hypocrisy. And then consider the amount of energy that mining a single Bitcoin requires for you green energy people out there, for you environmentalists. You begin to realize the hypocrisy of it all. You begin to realize that there is nothing about this that has anything to do with helping my autistic son and other kids like him get the medical treatment that they need. You realize that you're only expanding the free market. You're only expanding capitalism. You're only doing an investment. And it is not a public purpose thing. The idea of you're going to bring down the banks. My eyes rolled back so far I could see my brain. The religion in this is equivalent to the same people saying you're going to hell for sodomy. You're going to hell for coveting your neighbor's property. You're going to hell for getting a tattoo. Religion. Cryptocurrency. Religion. Again, not talking about whether it's good or bad per se, but talking about the religious beliefs, the zealotry behind it, the non-evidence-based belief system, the desire to be in control, to have knowledge that no one else does, to believe that you alone can bring down the government, bring it all crashing down with a simple investment in a Bitcoin. You cannot have a new deal playing the game of believing that somehow or another Bitcoin is going to supplant the dollar. Just think about that. Really, really think about that. And then after you think about that, ask yourself this. Have you ever seen the nation stand up and fight for a new deal? Forget a band of 50 people showing up at some march. Have you seen a consistent, focused effort, a campaign, not just activism, protesting with your fist in the air? An organized, systematic fight for a new deal. Have you ever seen it in your lifetime? Yes or no? The answer is no. You've never seen it. You can't get progressives to focus on a new deal for more than 5 minutes before they start talking about Bitcoin, or they start talking about the Rothschilds, or they start talking about some other religious belief that they have. Some non-actionable bullshit. Every time someone tells me it's all hopeless and futile, I ask, when have you seen the people unite and take to the streets in knowledge that they need Medicare for all, in knowledge that they need to end wars for oil and go to full-blown green energy yesterday? When have you ever seen a massive, coordinated, non-election year drive for this behavior? You've never seen it. And so guess what's going to happen during the election years when you try to hold them to a pledge or when you try to hold them to some other campaign promise? It's going to fall flat on its face. And I'll tell you why. You didn't do the footwork between now and then. You got sidetracked going to protest for Donald Trump's tax returns. You got sidetracked telling all your friends about how awesome your investment portfolio is and all the different cryptocurrencies you've gone and invested in. You couldn't stay focused long enough to create the momentum that takes years to build. So when you get people to make pledges and things like that, they're only as good as your ability to back them up. And that requires an organization. That requires a team on the street and in the cockpit, commanding and directing and keeping a sustained initiative in the election years and the off election years. There is no such thing as an end to a campaign like this. It has to be sustained day in, day out. It must be sustained. People get whiny when I try and explain to them to stay focused. They want to jump around, man. They love their identity politics. They love it. I mean, like, love it. Another religion. We have an incredible amount of inequity in this country, be it gender, be it race, be it age, be it geography, be it the way you were born, the lottery of parents by family line. But at the end of the day, we have never stayed committed and united in fighting for a new deal. You've never seen it in your lifetime. And if you have seen it, God bless you. You're an older individual, and I applaud you for sticking around for the next show, because it's been that long since our country had that kind of forward thinking. And because people don't understand the way the monetary system works, or because they don't understand how federal financing works, do you think for a minute that ignorance of how it works might make it difficult to focus on a massive new deal? Do you think it might be difficult to envision and dream about a new deal when you think the nation is broke? Do you think that if you believe the nation is in debt to Saudi Arabia and in debt to China and in debt to Russia and everyone else, do you think it might be a little difficult to have a new deal if that's the way you believe? Mind you, that is another religion. The debt is a religion. It's a cult. It is a real cult. Once you understand how this stuff works, you can call bullshit. You can call bullshit. And you can begin dreaming again. You can begin imagining a better future than even New Deal politics would give you. The world becomes a truly incredible place with incredible opportunities. But you're not going to get it from a political party. You're not going to get it from the new third parties right now because they're too busy trying to gather people into their fold, too busy trying to make nice with everybody, afraid to make ruffles because the name of the game is not to upset anyone. Play it safe. People are wondering, well, what is your platform going to be? Why is this even remotely controversial? It should be a new deal. There's your instant walk in the door, friggin' turnkey solution for a progressive agenda. The new goddamn deal. The second Bill of Rights. My God, if we had that, our lives would change immeasurably for the better. And if they actually understood economics, they wouldn't even have to raise your taxes and take money out of working families' hands to make it happen. It's important to not allow Occupy Democrats to give you economic advice. It's important to not allow some Bitcoiner to tell you that the national government is going bankrupt so they can make a few more bucks, a few more dollars on their Bitcoin investment. Hey, make a buck. I'm all down for it, man. I'm not here to tell you not to make money to protect your family. I am here to tell you that you're not going to get income equality. You're not going to get a job guarantee. You're not going to get Medicare for all. You're not going to wipe out student debt. You're not going to do any of these things if you keep trying to reinvigorate the private markets, the free markets, the invisible hand, and all the other bullshit. It's not going to happen. Do you understand the difference between state money and Bitcoin? Do you understand what the difference is? Or have you bought into another religion about the private banking cartel, the Federal Reserve, the one that gets all the press, millions of views, lots of clicks, lots of Alex Jones love, you name it. Another religion clouding our judgment, blocking our ability to demand a new deal. And for what? So the cool goth kids can talk in teen angst fashion about the Federal Reserve, man. Let me tell you something. The biggest lie that's ever been pulled over any of us is the idea that when the government spends, it will cause inflation. There is no greater lie that has been pulled on the American people than the belief that if the government spends, we're all going to die from inflation. You can thank Milton Friedman, the godfather of neoliberalism, for that. So naturally, if you're a progressive and you want a new deal and you believe that it's held by a private banking cartel and the government's broke and it can't do anything, naturally, the only thing you're going to believe is that we got to take these eternal pieces of paper from the rich so that we can afford nice things. And when I explain that that's not true, that we can make the rich irrelevant and do it in spite of them, because the government has always been the creator of its currency, with or without the Federal Reserve, just like it is in the UK, just like it is in Japan, just like it is in Australia, just like it is in Russia and China, etc. And the US, by the way. It's all the same thing. They sell bonds to take non-productive money out of the economy for a while, to quote unquote free up money, to spend new money on new productive things. However, when our government spends it on the military, nobody flinches. Nobody goes, holy shit, hyperinflation. Some bitch, we're going to have hyperinflation. You never hear it. Why is that? Because everyone loves a good James Bond story more than the truth. They want their religion. God damn it, give them bread and circuses. Give them religion. Keep them on the plantation with religion. The reality is that when the government stops spending on these public purpose things, It forced us to privatize solutions. This is the neoliberal hook. It's what they do to us. They leverage our religious beliefs and then they destroy us. They push us, hey, Social Security is broke. The government's stealing money from the Social Security accounts. We're all gonna die. Better go buy Bitcoin. Better go buy gold. Peter Schiff will tell you at 3 a.m. And these are great investments, maybe or maybe not. Depends on whether the bubble bursts. But the reason why people are desperate and destitute is not because banks have control of their lives. It's because our federal government has stopped spending on the people in support of the great lie that you're afraid of inflation. Now, if you're a bondholder at all, if you bought any kind of treasury bonds or security bonds or anything, you're praying for a little bit of inflation so you actually have something to come out of it. But they've got you scared. They've got you petrified. If the government spends on the people, everyone's going to die. It's going to be inflationary, hyperinflation, Weimar Republic. Well, and then you got the edgy dudes. You saw how great that worked in Weimar. It's kind of like Napoleon Dynamite. They're ignorant and they're stuck in their religion. Shiny, happy people losing my religion and all that other happy horse shit. The government is not going broke. It can do great things. So why are the Bitcoiners out there claiming that the collapse of the dollar is coming? Why are they running around screaming from the heights? Oh my God, if you don't buy Bitcoin, the world's going to end. You're going to be stuck. It's the whole system's falling apart. Who benefits from that? Ask yourself, who benefits from that lie? Seriously, ask yourself, who benefits from that lie? It's investors, people that are banking on you panicking over nothing so that they can watch their stock go up. You're being used as a pawn, as most religions do, to enrich the upper crust. It's just a different master this time. One apparently many people don't mind serving. This is no savior here, my friends. This is no Jesus Christ or Muhammad or anything else. This is a real Ponzi scheme. This is a real private free market thing with the goal of destroying the one thing that would give us a new deal, that would give you Medicare for all, that would give you student debt eradication, that would give you a federal job guarantee, would give you all these things. Now, no one should be scared of it because, quite frankly, it can't do anything. It can't do what the U.S. dollar can do. So because they know that, the next thing they start doing is saying, what happens when the dollar is no longer the world reserve currency? And that's when you go, oh, my God. God, what happens when the world's current reserve currency isn't the dollar? What happens? Oh my God, we're all gonna die. Buy Bitcoin. Oh my God. It's always fear porn. And it's always going after the boogeyman that was created because Congress doesn't spend on the people. And because Congress is neoliberal and doesn't spend on the people, and the people buy the lie because it's religion. The private banksters have their way with us because most of the money in the circulation right now is bank-denoted IOUs in the government's unit of account. Not new money. They didn't go out and print new money. They created IOUs, loans that create deposits that zero out when paid off. It's not printing money. At some point in time, you'd like the lights to turn on. But just like many religious people that will go to their grave saying, I can't allow someone to tell me something other than what I need to hear because I'm afraid I'll go to hell. If you tell me that it's something that violates my belief, I'll go to hell if I listen. I can't la 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 la, can't listen la la la, Bitcoin la 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 la. And this is what religion does to us. This is religion. Make no mistake about it. You know, I love the fact that not everything in this life is known up front. And sometimes we have to bump our nose, bump our heads to find the truth. Like old George over here. All great truths begin as blasphemies. Your taxes don't pay for spending at the federal level. Get over it. Your taxes and bonds do pay for state and local spending. When your state budgets are dried up and they want to raise taxes and the businesses leave your state, do you think there might be another solution that would fix the problem? Or are you just stuck in your religion? Are you just stuck repeating the same broken paradigm over and over again? And then you create your narratives to show how the man got you again, took you down again. We're all going to die. You know, these things come and they go. But ultimately, our greatest enemy is ignorance. Our ignorance empowers our oppressors. As long as you're dumb and religiously stubborn and holding to your beliefs, they'll continue to use the same exact lie to keep us from success. Shame on them for lying to us. Shame on the opportunists for preying on your fear. Shame on the capitalists for devising these strategies to get rich based on your fears. Shame on all of them. I mean, really. It's a shame. It really is a shame. And people won't change either. You know, I think to myself about this Karl Popper post here. True ignorance is not the absence of knowledge, but the refusal to acquire it. The refusal to acquire knowledge is really what is killing us. Folks, I try not to make this stuff up if I can help it. I try and come out here every night and tell you as much truth as I can fit into a live stream. I have talked to people and they get very, very butthurt when I explain that Bitcoin is not going to give you these very, very needed progressive things. A federal job guarantee would take every single person in every single impoverished area across America, and if implemented around the world, around the world. But in America, and it would give them a living wage, it would give them benefits like Medicare for all, free college, you name it. And depending upon how each local community administered it, it could give them tools for achieving even greater dreams in their lives. That is progressive policy. That is saving lives. Some jackass who bet big on Bitcoin a few years ago might be like Bill Gates giving some money away to charity someday. But that is not the same as providing a federal job guarantee, Medicare for all, getting rid of student debt, green energy yesterday. Does this make any fucking sense? Why am I fighting these crypto fascists day in and day out that claim to be progressive and get mad when I tell them, go invest in Bitcoin? But it is not saving lives. This is part of your Dungeons and Dragons club. If you want to be a tech weenie and have fun with these things, knock yourself out. Knock yourself out. But don't get in my way when I try to save lives while you're trying to make some money through your investments. Don't confuse the two of us. One of us is fighting for people, and the other is fighting to make a buck. Yeah, I got your number, Ayn Rand Society. Selfish people. Self-serving, self-centered, not seeking a progressive victory, not seeking a progressive agenda, seeking a personal agenda, an investment opportunity, just like the Wall Street people you just can't stand. Remember, Wall Street and the banks have power because our Congress has chosen to give it to them. You've been duped, and now it's your religion. And it's time to break the chains. And it's time for us to do an intervention and get you out of your religion. It's time to serve the 99%. I'm Steve Grumbine with Real Progressives. Have a good day, everybody.